When it comes to management of labor and delivery, we have come a long way from the ancient methods of delivery at home depicted in the picture at the top left to when we deliver in a tertiary care hospital shown in the picture on the bottom right. Today, I'm going to discuss an important topic, normal labor and its management. I will discuss it in three parts. In the first part, I will discuss the basics and management of first stage of labor. In the second part, management of second stage. And in the last part, management of third and fourth stages. To understand the topic even better, please refer to my textbook, Modern Obstetrics. In the last 40 years, there has been a steady decline in the rate of normal vaginal deliveries. This decrease has occurred as a result of changes in the management of several obstetrics conditions, including malpresentation, fetal distress, prior cesarean section, and dystocia. The alarming increase in the rate of cesarean deliveries in modern obstetrics has occurred at the expense of corresponding decline in the vaginal delivery rate. The situation is so alarming that some fear that a day may arise when vaginal delivery will become extinct. To quote Sir T.N.A. Jeffcott, labor can be the most dangerous journey a human ever undertakes. To give you another quotation, life is a journey, not a destination. It begins with birth. Labor is the culmination of pregnancy whereby the fetus, amniotic fluid, placenta, and membranes are separated and expelled from the uterus via the cervico-vaginal canal. WHO defines normal birth as spontaneous in onset, low risk at the start of labor, and remaining so throughout labor and delivery. The infant is born spontaneously in the vertex anterior position between 37 and 42 completed weeks of gestation. At birth, mother and infant are in good condition. When talking about labor, three terms are used: eutosia, dystocia, and oxytocia. Dystocia is defined as abnormal or difficult labor, whereas eutosia describes normal labor or childbirth, and oxytocia describes rapid labor. Dystocia is of three types. Maternal dystocia may be bony or cervical dystocia. Causes of fetal dystocia are malposition, malpresentations, and shoulder dystocia. Morbidly adherent placenta and placenta accreta, which can delay the third stage of labor, can be considered as a type of placental dystocia. The clinical definition of normal labor is as follows. Labor is said to be normal, that is eutosia, when a fetus presenting by vertex anterior position is delivered vaginally at full term by natural maternal efforts without undue delay, usually less than 24 hours, and without complications to the mother or fetus. Delivery cannot be said to be normal until the woman has delivered. Hence, labor is normal only in retrospect. Labor is divided into four stages. First stage begins from the onset of labor to full dilatation and effacement of cervix. Second stage extends from full dilatation and effacement of cervix to birth of the baby. Third stage extends from birth of the baby to delivery of placenta. Fourth stage is an arbitrary stage from delivery of placenta until the vital parameters of the mother have stabilized. This table shows the duration of these stages in primary gravida and multipara. First stage of labor is further subdivided into three phases: the latent phase, the active phase, and the transitional phase, which extends from 8 to 10 centimeters dilatation of cervix. Please note that in modern obstetrics, based on new evidence, active phase starts when the cervix is 6 centimeters dilated and not 4. Remember, 6 is the new 4. To know whether labor has begun, one must know the signs of onset of labor, which are onset of labor pains, which increase in frequency and intensity as time passes, palpation of uterine contractions, which coincide with labor pains, commencing dilatation of cervix, formation of a bag of waters or membrane, and SHO, which is passage of blood-stained mucoid discharge. This table shows the differences between true and false labor. I am not going into details of the same. Having discussed the basics, I will now talk at length about the clinical management of normal labor. When the woman comes to the receiving room with labor pains, first take her detailed obstetric history, perform a detailed clinical examination, which includes general examination, per-abdominal and per-vaginal examination to ensure that the patient is in labor and not in false labor. Don't forget to review her antenatal chart to look for any high-risk factors. If she has a pink card, it suggests that she is a high-risk patient. To prepare the patient for a safe vaginal delivery and to carefully monitor any deviation from normal, following preparations are done. Private parts are shaved, evacuation of the rectum by a simple soap water enema. The patient is asked to take a hot water bath. The patient wears a clean gown. A blood sample should be obtained for hemoglobin, grouping cross matching of 1 unit of blood, and a urine specimen must be obtained for protein and glucose determination. Progress of normal labor should be monitored closely. Temperature, pulse and respiratory rate should be checked every half an hour. Blood pressure every 2 hours, and fetal heart sounds should be checked every 15 to 30 minutes using a fetoscope or a Doppler. If facilities available, electronic fetal monitoring can also be done in normal labor. Ambulation is encouraged in a patient in normal labor. Ideally, a partograph must be maintained in every patient in labor, even if everything is normal. Please refer to my separate video on partograph. An intravenous line must be kept to tackle any bleeding emergencies that may arise. The patient is encouraged to pass urine from time to time, and if she cannot, an intermittent simple rubber catheterization may be needed to keep the bladder empty. Remember, empty bladder prevents uterine inertia and helps descent of the placentic part. If the patient desires, labor analgesia may be given. Usually, epidural labor analgesia is preferred. I want to make a few comments on cervical dilatation because often mistakes are made by juniors about the degree of dilatation and effacement of cervix. Here, I have given two ways to judge the correct amount of dilatation of cervix. One based on the number of fingers, loose or tight, that can be admitted into the cervix, and other based on common eating items. If the cervical opening is the size of a cherry, the cervix is 2 cm dilated. If the diameter is that of a lime slice, it is 4 cm dilated. And if it is 8 cm, it is the size of an orange slice. A fully dilated cervix is the size of a bagel. Before we go on to the management of second stage of labor, one must know the signs of transition from first to second stage. These are increased bloody show, rectal pressure, anal canal dilatation, which is considered as a bearing down sensation, tremors in thighs and legs, and lastly, she feels she is losing control. Now I will discuss the management of second stage of labor in great details. Continuing from the first part where we saw that the patient is showing signs that she is fully dilated and ready to deliver, the patient is transferred on a wheelchair or a trolley to the delivery room and put on a special labor cot in a lithotomy position. The lower abdomen, upper part of the thighs, vulva and perineum are swabbed with antiseptic lotion. Sterile leggings and drapes are applied. The obstetrician should ideally wear a sterile cap, mask, gown and gloves. That is, strict aseptic precautions must be taken at the time of the actual delivery of the baby. Unlike the first stage of labor, the patient now needs much more frequent monitoring. temperature, pulse and respiration and blood pressure are taken every 5 minutes and the details of uterine contractions are noted. Fetal heart sounds are auscultated every 5 minutes instead of 15 minutes and after each contraction. The bladder, if distended, may be emptied with a sterile, simple rubber catheter. Traditional obstetric practice dictates that the parturient begin pushing when the cervix attains full dilatation, that is 10 centimeters. However, some clinicians have questioned this practice and suggested delaying pushing until the presenting fetal part has descended and or the patient feels the urge to push. The optimum pushing technique is unclear too. Women are typically told to pull back their knees, take a deep breath and bear down at the start of a uterine contraction and push with a closed glottis, that is Valsalva pushing, for 10 seconds with the goal of 3 pushes per contraction. Valsalva pushing is not recommended these days as there is no clinically significant benefit to this technique. Instead, the patient should be allowed to bear down when she feels the need, that is spontaneous pushing or physiological pushing, unless epidural anesthesia has impacted the bearing down sensation. The more important thing to remember is that the patient should bear down with each uterine contraction and relax in between. Before talking about giving an episiotomy before the actual delivery, I will say a few words about perineal massage. Antepartum and intrapartum perineal massage have been proposed as a means of softening and stretching the perineum to reduce perineal trauma during birth. Although not harmful, it is not routinely recommended because there is insufficient quality of evidence proving its benefit. However, it would be very useful for those women who are going to be delivered without an episiotomy. I am going to describe the normal delivery of a primary gravida after giving a mediolateral episiotomy as we do in our institution. When the woman is about to deliver, first a perineal infiltration is performed and then just before crowning, a mediolateral episiotomy is given at the height of a uterine contraction. Remember, in the Western world, routine use of episiotomy is not recommended for a primary gravida. But in India, we routinely give a mediolateral episiotomy. And now, I will describe in detail the delivery of the head using a maneuver called as modified Ridgen's maneuver. When the fetal head is about to deliver, with a sterile pad in one hand, manual pressure is applied upwards and anteriorly on the perineum and with the two fingers of the other hand applying downwards pressure on the fetal occiput just below the pubic symphysis, the head is delivered by gradual extension in between uterine contractions until crowning occurs. This method prevents sudden compression and decompression of the fetal head that could occur with sudden popping out of the head. If this is the modified Ridgen's maneuver, it is but natural that you will ask me what is the original Ridgen maneuver. As shown in the diagram here, Ridgen originally performed this maneuver through the rectum. We do not do this anymore. Although there is controversy regarding routine use of episiotomy, there is a general consensus that perineal support during delivery using the modified Ridgen's maneuver is very important as it reduces direct pressure on the perineum, thus preventing perineal trauma. The body usually slips without difficulty, otherwise it is delivered by gentle traction to produce lateral flexion by hooking the fingers in the baby's axillae. Here's a short video showing the actual delivery of head and trunk of the fetus. It's not actually a normal delivery. It shows what to do if there is a loop of cord around the body. Remember, in India, it is very important to note the exact time of delivery in hours, minutes and seconds. After delivery, ensure that the baby cries and resuscitate if necessary. Clamp the cord at two places and cut in between. Collect the cord blood and ligate the cord. Here's a short clip showing clamping and cutting of the umbilical cord. The cord should be clamped 10 cm away from the umbilicus at two places 5 cm apart using two straight Cocker's forceps or hemostats, and cut in between with sterile blunt end scissors. And now I will talk at length about immediate versus delayed cutting of the umbilical cord. This debate has now been resolved. ACOG recommends that umbilical cord clamping be delayed for at least 30 to 60 seconds after birth in a vigorous preterm or a term infant. Delayed clamping with the infant maintained at or below the level of the placenta is advisable because of the associated neonatal benefits such as increased blood volume, reduced need for blood transfusion, and decreased incidence of intracranial hemorrhage in preterm infants. Studies have shown that around 80 ml of blood is transferred from the placenta to the fetus within 1 minute of birth, which appears to be facilitated by newborn's initial breathing efforts. This initial transfer of blood supplies significant quantities of iron, that is 40 to 50 milligrams per kilogram body weight, and is associated with a lower risk of iron deficiency anemia during the first year of life. What about milking of the umbilical cord? As an alternative to delayed clamping, the umbilical cord can be milked towards the fetus to enhance blood transfusion. There is some evidence that it helps to stabilize blood pressure and increase urinary output in premature infants. However, I believe that delivery should not be unnecessarily delayed to milk the cord in situations where immediate pediatric assistance is needed, such as thick meconium stain lichen or neonatal depression. Also, it should not be done if collection of cord blood is planned. Cord blood collected for diagnostic purposes is usually obtained by allowing blood to drain from the cut end into a glass tube prior to delivery of the placenta. Cord blood may be tested for blood type and Rh or to screen for a variety of newborn conditions as indicated. Remember that if blood is needed for pH testing, it should be collected from the umbilical artery by a needle and syringe to minimize exposure to air and avoid mixing of arterial and venous blood. If fine, the baby should be put to mother's breast, but if the baby does not cry, then the baby is handed over to a neonatologist for neonatal resuscitation. Lastly, note the 1 minute and 5 minute Apgar scores. If the baby does not cry, then the baby is handed over to a neonatologist for neonatal resuscitation. If the lichen was meconium stained, many perform nasopharyngeal suction to remove the meconium. However, the American Heart Association, the American Academy of Pediatrics, and the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists recommend against routine intrapartum suctioning of meconium-stained infants who are vigorous at birth. This concludes the second part of my e-lecture on management of normal labor. In this third and final part of my e-lecture on management of normal labor, I'm going to discuss management of the most crucial and unforgiving third stage of labor and also the fourth stage. In modern obstetrics, active management is universally preferred over the physiological wait and watch policy, and therefore I'm going to discuss only that. The aim of active management of third stage of labor, which is known in short as AMSTEL, is prevention of complications of third stage, particularly postpartum hemorrhage. AMSTEL is a series of actions taken by the obstetrician after vaginal delivery of the baby to prevent postpartum hemorrhage.
The three main components of AMSTEL, according to FIGO, are illustrated here. These are administration of an anabolic agent, delivery of placenta by controlled cord traction method, and uterine fundal massage. Please note that immediate or delayed clamping of the cord is not universally accepted as part of active management of third stage of labor. I will discuss them in more details now. The first and most important component of AMSTEL is administration of 10 units of oxytocin given intramuscularly within 1 minute of delivery of the baby. In some institutes, oxytocin is given after delivery of the anterior shoulder of the fetus. This shortens the duration of the third stage of labor. Although 10 units of oxytocin given IM is standard of care in Western countries, in low-resource countries like India, we prefer 600 micrograms of misoprostol given orally or per rectum, or 125 micrograms of prostodine injection given intramuscularly. Injection methyl ergometrine 0.2 mg can also be given for prevention of postpartum hemorrhage. The reason why oxytocin is not preferred in low-resource countries is because it needs to be refrigerated. In rural areas, this may not be possible. Misoprostol, on the other hand, is available as oral tablets that do not require refrigeration. Before I talk about the second component, that is delivery of the placenta by controlled cord traction, one must know what are the signs of placental separation. These are gush of blood from the vagina, fundal height rises, that is known as balling up of the uterus, suprapubic fullness, apparent lengthening of the umbilical cord, and upward suprapubic pressure on the uterus does not draw the cord up. This video shows how the placenta is delivered by the controlled cord traction method, which is also known as the Brand Andrews method. In this maneuver, placental delivery is accomplished by applying controlled cord traction with one hand while the other hand placed on the fundus or the abdomen pushes the uterus upwards in opposite direction. Slowly rotating the placenta in circles as it is delivered or grasping the membranes with a clamp helps prevent them from tearing and possibly being retained in the uterine cavity. This video shows how the placenta and its membranes must be examined after delivery to make sure that they are complete. The placenta is laid flat on the table with first the fetal side up and then the maternal side up. The membranes can be separated into two parts, the chorion and the amnion, as shown here. On the maternal side, check for any missing cotyledons. Then the cut umbilical cord stump must be examined for three blood vessels, which are seen normally. Two are arteries and one is the vein, as shown here. This video shows the third component of active management of third stage of labor, which is
uterine massage.
This involves checking that the uterus is contracted. The uterus must be palpated and a fundal massage must be done every 15 minutes for 2 hours after placental delivery. And now, some evidence-based medicine. How useful is AMSTEL? Studies have shown that AMSTEL reduces the risk of postpartum hemorrhage by about 60%. It is now a grade A recommendation. Using a speculum and a pair of sponge holding forceps, the cervix and vagina are inspected after any normal delivery for lacerations, which if present and bleeding are sutured. The episiotomy must be promptly sutured in 3 layers as shown here in this animation. Routine exploration of the uterine cavity is no longer recommended for normal deliveries or those following previous cesarean delivery.
In the end, I will talk about an arbitrary stage called as the fourth stage of labor. This is an arbitrary stage where the patient is observed in the labor ward for 2 hours. During this time, check the vital parameters, check vulvar pads for bleeding per vaginam, repeat uterine massage by the nursing staff or the patient herself. After ensuring that all the parameters are normal, uterus is contracted and episiotomy is sutured, the mother and baby are sent to the postnatal ward. In most maternity hospitals, baby is kept with the mother and this is called rooming in. If you want to know more about this topic or any other topic in obstetrics and gynecology, please refer to my books Modern Gynecology, Modern Obstetrics and Practical Obstetrics and Gynecology and other books. The links are given below. They are available on Amazon.in. For purchase inquiries, contact me on this WhatsApp number. I have also published 2 question answer books which are particularly useful for exam going students. These are Clinical Cases in Obstetrics, 1000 plus questions and answers, and Clinical Cases in Gynecology, 1000 plus questions and answers. These are also available on Amazon.in. You can also follow me on other social media platforms like Facebook and Instagram. The links are given here. If you enjoyed this video, hit the like button, share it with your friends, and also subscribe to my channel for more videos like this. Thank you for watching.